Morning. I know that you are almost as excited as I am to have Pastor Darren back in the house, and excited for next week for you to be back in the preaching saddle up here with a fresh word, and we're looking forward to that. I know last week, if you were here, Pastor Chad had an incredible and timely, I believe, message on God's waiting room, just in those seasons of waiting for God. But knowing that Pastor Darren would be back next week and knowing that he's going to begin a new series, I wanted to come back to and finish up our series that we are in called Filled. Say filled. There you go. Come on. So we are continuing. We're going to wrap up this series. It's been just an incredible, practical look at the Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit's role in our lives, how that plays out for us as believers, how it plays out for us as the church. And I want to give you, let me give you a one-sentence recap. So if you missed any weeks, if you haven't been here, if this is your first Sunday, welcome, excited you're here. Here's the recap of this whole series so far and kind of the lead-in of what today is all about. Here's the point of filled. We are filled by Jesus. We're filled by Jesus with the Holy Spirit. So here's what we understand. Jesus is the one that fills us. He's the one that does the filling. So in Scripture says John baptized with water, but Jesus will baptize with the Holy Spirit and with fire. So Jesus is the one that fills us. He's the one that sends the Holy Spirit to be with us, and we are filled with the Holy Spirit. That's an idea of submersion, just like an idea of baptism, that we are completely submerged in, deep into the Holy Spirit, that He surrounds our lives, and He's not only beside us, but He is in us. The line that I'm going to take from this whole series that will stick out forever, I believe, is that Jesus beside me is not as good as the Holy Spirit in me. That's powerful. That's what Jesus said. It was His own words to His disciples. It's better that I go so the Holy Spirit can come and be in you. And so Jesus beside me is not as valuable to me now as a believer as the Holy Spirit in me. So we are baptized, we are filled by Jesus with the Holy Spirit. That is for a reason. That reason is to be encouraged as the church, to encourage each other. You look at the gifts of the Spirit in 1 Corinthians 12 and 13 and 14, we understand that the gifts of the Spirit are designed to build up the body, to encourage the body, to encourage one another so that we can be equipped, we can be filled up, we can use and lean on each other in every single day. So the reason is encouraging each other to be His church. And that's the point of today, to be His church. If we're to leave off that last line, if we were just to stick with the fact that we're filled by Jesus with the Holy Spirit to encourage one another and leave off the end of being His church, then we miss that final action piece that really defines the work of the Holy Spirit. That's the end result of what the Holy Spirit wants to do in us. Now, here's the good promise. Here's the beautiful part of the Holy Spirit. He is deeply personal. The Holy Spirit wants a personal, deep, intimate connection with you, a relation with you, a connection spiritually with you. So we use words to describe the Holy Spirit like comforter and helper, encourager, counselor, right? That's who He is. It is deeply personal for me, in me, with me. That's this Holy Spirit. But all of that is then in preparation for me to be active in the calling God has on my life and in the life of the church. So we have to understand that balance. There's this intimate personal relationship with the Holy Spirit as Jesus fills us, as Jesus equips us with His Spirit, and all of that is for the purpose of being His church. So I grew up playing sports, like many children that grow up in America, right? I grew up playing sports. I played every sport, loved doing it, was super involved, was not always that great, but thrived in just my enjoyment of it. I loved doing that. I got to play soccer in college, not because I am a peak collegiate athlete, but because I went to a very small Bible college, and they had space on the team. So I played, but I can still tell people I was a collegiate athlete. So I got to do that. I loved playing sports. I love now I get to coach my son. It's the most surreal thing in the world, because even at those times, when I was 17 years old playing sports growing up, I was like, someday I'm going to coach my kid in Little League. All right? There's moments that are super great and nostalgic, and then there's moments that half the 5-year-olds are just laying on the soccer field. If you ever need some great entertainment, Saturdays at 3 o'clock. Come watch a group of five-year-olds play soccer against each other. It's a blast for those watching, and it's a little frustrating for those coaching, but it's fun. We love it. But I just love the environment that the sports bring. I am passionate about it. But I can tell you what I was not passionate about while I played sports. Practice. Was never passionate about practice. I never longed for going to practice. I didn't look forward to it, to be very honest. When I played in college, when I played at Central Bible College playing soccer, the worst thing that ever happened was showing up to a soccer practice, and we would look around. There was a few of these days throughout the year, and I'd say, "Coach, where's the soccer balls?" And he said, "We don't need them." And you knew for the next 2 hours, we're running the whole time. I hate to run. Running's pointless. I only want to run if I'm kicking something or catching something or throw. Like, I want to run if there's purpose in it. I don't want to run for the sake of running. And he would say, "On the line." And we would get on the line. There was a fast group and a slow group. I won't tell you which group I was in, but I went second. And we would get on the line. And you had to go down and back. That was one. And then you'd do it twice. And that was two. And you had to go three times. And then four. And then five. And then four. And then three. And then two. And then one. We called it ladders. And it, to this day, makes just my whole body tremble in fear. We don't need soccer balls. We're running ladders today. It's the worst. I hated practice. But you know why it was worth it? You know why I did it? Game day. Whew, I love game day. Love putting on the jersey. I even tell our five-year-olds, I say, they got these awesome-looking soccer jerseys. I say, "Hey, if you look good, you feel good. You feel good, you play good. You play good, they pay good." There's no paying in five-year-old soccer, but we do give them gummy bears at the end of the game because we call ourselves the gummy bears. So I said, "They pay good when you play good." But I love getting the jersey on. Like, even now, if I play indoor soccer, I put on my red t-shirt with my number on the back. I'm like, "Whoo, it's game day. I feel good." I love that. But I can promise you, if that part didn't exist, if there was no game day, I'm not going to practice. I don't have a love of the game enough to just grind out practices, to get up early to go run, to show up and not even get to kick a ball, but just to run in preparation of a game that's not going to happen. I wasn't about that. I'm not that into it. It's like watching a Rocky movie, and all you have is training montage, and there's never a fight at the end. So I got the eye of the tiger, and he's in the gym sweating, but we never get to the ring. There's a disconnect there. And I think that a lot of us have misunderstood the fact that church is not game day. Sunday morning, we'll change our vocabulary. Our Sunday morning gathering isn't the moment we've all been waiting for. Our Sunday morning gathering is training time, where we prepare, where we're encouraged, when we're equipped, when we put the work in so that we're ready for game day. We're ready for action. We're ready to put into practice all that we have learned and been taught and been equipped with. We prepare in this room to then go and be the church. Practice is only worth it when there's a payoff of the game, when there's a payoff of putting into action, into life, what we have been working and studying and learning and growing. And so there's a major underlying purpose and outcome of being filled with the Spirit. And that's for us to be the church. That's an active word. Be the church. There's movement in that. There's life in that. There's purpose in that. Jesus said in a famous exchange with Peter that he would build his church and the gates of hell wouldn't prevail against it. It's in Matthew chapter 16. We're going to read just a few verses here in verse 15. It says, "Then he asked them, 'But who do you say I am?'" Jesus had asked his disciples, "Who do other people say that I am? Who are the crowds saying I am?" And they said, "Well, they think you're a prophet, or they think you're reincarnated, one of the ancient teachers. We think all these things." He said, "Who do you say I am?" In verse 16, Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." And Jesus replied, "You are blessed, Simon, son of John, because my Father in heaven has revealed this to you. You did not learn this from any human being. And now I say to you that you are Peter," which means rock, "and upon this rock I will build my church, and all the powers of hell will not conquer it." So Peter means rock, but Jesus was not simply saying that he would build his church on Peter. We know that his church is far beyond any one human. He was reminding Peter of who he was. Jesus is really good at that, reminding us who we are, who he's called us to be. He's reminding Peter, hey, you're a solid rock. But upon this rock, what rock? On the foundation of what Peter had said about Jesus is what he would build his church on. See, what Peter realized from God is that this is the real deal. This is not just another prophet. This is not just another miracle worker. This is the Messiah, the Savior we have been waiting for, who is sent by God himself. And Jesus said, upon that rock, that confession, that truth, that I came to save the world from their sins, that I was sent by God, that I am the Son of the living God, that confession, which we now call the gospel. The gospel is that Jesus came to save sinners, that God raised him from the dead, that he was sent by God himself. Upon that gospel, I will build my church. And this church that he is calling us to be is not a person, right? It's not Peter, and it's not a pastor, as great as that may be. It's not a staff member. It's not an evangelist. It's not one great voice. That's not the church he's calling us to be. It's not a single location. As great as it might be to have a good location and a great building, it's not a location. It's not the church he's calling us to be. No building is the extent of his church. The church he's calling us to be is not man-made. We can use our gifts and our talents and our efforts and our own will to build something as great as we possibly can, but the church that he's building, he's building. He said, I will build my church. Psalm 127:1 says, unless the Lord builds the house, the work of the builders is wasted. Right? If it's not God doing the building, we are wasting our efforts and our times building something that looks good for us that is not what he has designed, not what he has planned, not what he has called us to. Unless the Lord builds the house. I love another translation that says, the builders labor in vain. There's this work that goes in, and it's just in vain. Because he's the one that builds the house. He's the one that builds his church. He's the one doing the work. It's his church. Pastor Dana has poured this into us since he began preaching here just a few months ago. It's been a long time, but since he began regularly preaching here. Not without him, right? That was the first message. We talk about it in our staff chapel every week. Not without him. We don't do this without God. It comes from that famous exchange with God and Moses. They're on the mountain, and God basically promises them everything that they needed. He said, I'll go with you. Or no, he said, I'll send you out. You're going to have all you need. I'm going to conquer your enemies. We'll provide for you, but I'm not going. And Moses said, if you're not going, don't send us out from this place. We don't want to go without you. And the church that God is building is not something we can do without him. It's not a body of people that look the right way. It's not the building that we can create. It's not the programs that we can develop. It's not anything our minds can come up with. The church he's creating is the only thing that he's creating. It's his plan. So biblically, the church is not a building. And I know we know this, but we have grown up in a world that has always experienced and vocalized that we go to church. Where do you go to church? Where do you attend church? Where do you show up on a Sunday morning that we call the church? What's the building look like that you call church? And we know that might not be the full extent of it, but this is the way our minds work. This is the church. We get up and go to church. My mom ingrained in us growing up. We go to church every Sunday morning, every Sunday night, every Wednesday night, and often two or three more times in the week. We go to church. But biblically, the church is never a building. It's a people. You read the Bible, and there's so many metaphors that are used for church. It's a body. In Romans 12 and 1 Corinthians 12, we're going to get to those verses in a little bit. It's the bride of Christ, right? That's a people. That's a personal relationship. It's a flock of sheep. The Bible describes the church as sheep. We're here at the No Regrets Sheep Farm on 15th and Bryant. Like, this is who we are. We're a flock of sheep. It's a family. That's words that we love to use here at Spring Creek. We believe that this is a family. That we come together as family. And none of those things have anything to do with where you go, but much more about who you are. You can't go to a body. You're a part of the body or you're not. You can't go to a family. You don't go to family. You just are. My family is my family. I don't go to family. I just am a part of the family. So in the Bible, there's never a plea for people to go to church, but there's constantly a plea for non-believers to become part of the church, to become part of the family, to become part of the bride of Christ, all of these ways that we describe it. And when you're a part of the church, that meant that you were deeply involved in and committed to the life and well-being of the church, which means the other believers. You're in. You're in or you're not in. There's no showing up and not showing up. And here's why this matters. Here's why this isn't just, it's not just semantics. It's not just, well, we're saying different things. No, here's why we have to ingrain this in our brains, because the world we live in, the church we grew up thinking about, the way we've defined it in our mind, and the way that America views the church, let's just keep it here in our context, the way that we view the church in this culture has put us in a place where we have substituted seeing ourselves as the church, and we see the church as a building we go to, and we fundamentally miss out on a lot of what it means to be a Christian. Because when I separate church out to something I go to, then I don't see myself as part of it, right? There's a separation there. There's me and there's the church, but we're not one and the same. And it's not biblical. And if you look around, here's what happens. It leads us to a path of Christian consumerism. And I'm not calling you out. I'm not calling Spring Creek. I'm calling the church out. Here's the tendency when we view the church as a building. It leads us to a place of Christian consumerism where the church, which in our mind exists apart from me, is supposed to serve me and meet my needs and preferences. All right, we'll search online to see what is the church offering me. Are they teaching something that I need to hear? Is there an event for me? Is there something to meet my needs? Is there something that I can receive? What do I get from the church? When I'm separate from it, I'm naturally going to view it that way. The church serving my needs, the church serving what I'm hoping for. When I'm part of the church, when I am the church, there's no disconnect there. And honestly, viewing the church in a way like that, when I'm not part of it, but it's separate, it turns the church into this vending machine of religious goods and services that I come and make my selections on a weekly basis. I think I'll come today because I could use some good worship. I like this teaching series. I don't like this teaching series, so I'll be back next month. Or, oh, he's preaching. I'll come back next week. Oh, good, there's finally an event for me. I'll take that. Ah, that one I don't really fit into. And we... not that we do this intentionally or with any negativity in our mind, but when the church is separate from me, then I'm just looking at what it does for me. But when I am the church, when the church is this body of believers and I see it that way and know it that way, that's why the semantics matters. That's why the words matter. When I know that I am the church, then my life is now driven by what God is wanting to do because he's building his church. So I'm following his lead. I'm following his example. Here's what I know. I am confident that Jesus cares more about our love for each other, about our love for God and his word, and our focus on our community than he does the particulars of where, when, and how we meet together in person. Now, hear this balance, because I'm always about balance. It's my life word. It is important for us to meet together. It is so important for us to meet together. It is so important for us to be encouraged together, connected together, give life to each other. There's protection here in the body. There's all these things that happen when we come together. But if coming together is our definition of church, if the building we show up to is our definition of church, if the where, when, and how is what consumes our mind, then we're missing the purpose that Jesus is calling us to, which is being the church. The church isn't a building, it's a people. People that love God, that love others, people that celebrate together, the people that continue on the work of Jesus to seek and to save the lost. You know, really in Scripture, the only things that defined church were God's people and God's presence. If you have those things, you have church. Jesus said, where two or three are gathered, I'm right there in the midst of them. So you don't need a minimum of 40 or 100 or 1,000 to now be having church. You don't need speaker systems and a preacher and a band. You don't need those things. What you need is his presence and his people. And here's where us being filled with the Spirit ties in with that. Here's where being filled fulfills that. The Holy Spirit is the fulfillment in the year 2020 of the promise of Jesus being Emmanuel. Emmanuel means God is with us. You're going to hear that soon in the Christmas season, right? We love, like, it's a great understanding during the Christmas season that Jesus came to be with us. One of the greatest promises and experiences of this Christian life is realizing that Jesus left heaven, took on the form of a human, and came to be with us. It's so powerful. Literally changed everything. But he said, it's better that I go and the Holy Spirit comes to be with you. So now we are filled with his presence, with his Spirit, and Emmanuel, God with us, continues right now in 2020, even though Jesus is back in heaven, because God has sent his own Spirit to be with us. So now when we gather together, it has very little to do with a building structure or an organizational layout or liturgical habits. He let us know that his people and his presence are the only necessary ingredients. We've been filled with his presence. We've been filled with his Spirit. And we are his people. So being the church is an active thing. Being the church is continually moving, and it's not stagnant. It's not still. It's not a building, because a building doesn't move, doesn't go. Being the church is what we're called to. So here's just, let me give you three things. What does being the church look like? Number one, it looks like growing in unity. Growing in unity, and that's, again, that is active. When we look at all the metaphors that we read about of, well, what is the church? It's a body, and it's the bride, and it's a flock of sheep, and it's a family. It's about people. It's about relationships. And I don't know if you know this, but the more people you get together, the more differences you're going to have. The more different opinions, the more different personalities, the more different everything have joined together to be one body. And so there is a active nature in us growing in our unity, in us growing in relationship together. You know this in your personal relationships. You see this play out in how you grow with your relationship with your children, with your spouse, with family members. You grow continually in your relationship. I didn't always understand that that was a never-ending process. I get now that that's a never-ending process. Been married 10 years, and I honestly thought, I used to joke when I had been married a year or two, I would preach and go, hey, I got this marriage thing figured out. And that was a joke. But I thought at that time, I mean, but by like, certainly by year 7, 8, by year 10, I would have this thing figured out. I mean, I honestly thought at some point, this thing just gets on a loop, and we got it figured out. At some point, communication is automatic, and we just get it, and we have our routines, and everything makes sense. Turns out that's not true. We just had our 10th wedding anniversary earlier this year, and I still make some of the same communication mistakes that I made before we even got married. There's still times that we disagree, and I'm like, how is this possible? We should be on the same wavelength. Every child you add just makes it even more chaotic. We're going to go for number 3 and just throw everything up in the air and see what happens. But we are consistently growing in relationship together, even after 10 years of marriage. I remember sitting at a conference a couple of years ago when I still thought, at least, surely by year 10, this is just going to be automatic. And I was sitting at a conference, we were in a breakout session, it was a husband and wife, and they had been married 25 years, and just talking about how they're changing, even now, their relationship. They're like, we've had to change some things. Here's how we've changed our communication. We've worked on this and changed this. And I was like, what? Certainly you've got it figured out by now. You got to get to year 25, year 30, year 40. When at some point do you just, you're done. We've reached perfect relationship. It's not going to happen. I know that now. I'm so wise. Took me a while. But we know in relationships, even the most intimate wedding marriage relationships, even in those, there's consistent growth and need for consistent growth. There's a need for consistent communication. There's a need for consistent forgiveness and understanding and patience and kindness towards one another. That is growing in us constantly. So how much more with people that we don't have intimate relationship with, that we become part of the family with, do we need to have consistent communication and growth and forgiveness and patience and unity and love together? It is an active thing that we're a part of. Because we who are many form one body. We come from different backgrounds and different histories and different understandings and different personalities. And Romans 12 says, just as our bodies have many parts and each part has a special function, so it is with Christ's body. We are many parts of one body and we all belong to each other. So I believe forgiveness is a consistent growing thing in our unity together. Patience, Scripture says, to make allowance for each other's faults. I ask you to make allowance for my faults, and I promise I will try my best to make allowance for your faults, because standing on a platform or having the word pastor in front of your name does not exempt you from mistakes. We're people. And I believe each one of us need to make allowance for each other's faults, understanding that we are coming together as a family, as a body, as a people of God to accomplish His purpose. But being the church looks like growing in that unity. Showing up at the same time on a Sunday and singing the same chorus does not mean we have achieved the final stage of unity. It's a consistent, active thing in our relationships together. The second thing that we look at when we're talking about being the church means that we are active in outreach. We are active in outreach. Just like we know that the building is not the church, if the only ministry that the church accomplishes happens within these four walls at 8:30 and 10:45 and 7 o'clock on Wednesdays, then we have not accomplished what God has called us to be as a church. We haven't reached the people He wants us to reach. We haven't done the things He wants us to do because all of our ministry is here focused. We don't sit back and go, oh, well, I hope people show up so we can tell them about Jesus. We must be active in looking outside of our walls and looking into our community and meeting needs and reaching lives and being involved with what is happening in the world around us, not closing our doors and hiding out, but going as the salt and light of the earth to be involved in the life of the world around us, because that's who the church is. We are called to be noticed. We are called to be seen. We are called to go and do, to outreach, to meet needs. It's the definition of we as a people. And the longer that we just look inward at what's happening here, the longer that defines church for us, the more we're missing the mission field God has called us to. And yes, we must go and preach, and we'll get to that in point three. But I believe that if we are not meeting the needs of the church or meeting the needs of the world around us, they care little what we have to say from the platform. But when the community knows us as ones that are involved, ones that are outside of these walls, ones that are meeting needs, ones that are showing love, when they see that in us, they'll be very interested to hear about this Jesus that we serve. We say in youth ministry that no one cares how much you know until you know how much they care. Right? There's got to be a tangible expression of our love for people seen in our community to fulfill our role as the church. And so we're leaning into that, and we have so far to go, but let me tell you, it's our heartbeat. You heard us talk about, or maybe you didn't if you're new, but you heard us talk about this Wednesday, the YMCA is going to be spending the day here because they have so many students in Edmond from A and B groups together that need a place to be. So we're going to have 33 families impacted by using our facility on a Wednesday so they can meet together and have a place for their kids to go, a place that they can have time to study. We're partnering with an organization called Restore OKC. They just had their ribbon-cutting grand opening. We're going to be partnering with them to meet needs in our community. You heard Pastor Anthony say Friday morning, we're going to feed breakfast to the Santa Fe football team. And you might look at that and go, what does that have to do with the gospel? What does that have to do with being in the church? It defines the church. Feeding a breakfast to a bunch of hungry football players is an extension of us expressing the love of Christ so that they know we care and they care to listen to what we have to say. We're believing that simple acts of outreach will open doors for people to receive this message about who Jesus is. Here's why it matters. Matthew chapter 25, verse 34 through 40. Then the king will say to those on his right, come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the creation of the world. For I was hungry and you fed me. I was thirsty and you gave me a drink. I was a stranger and you invited me into your home. I was naked and you gave me clothing. I was sick and you cared for me. I was in prison and you visited me. And then these righteous ones will reply, Lord, when did we ever see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? Or a stranger and show you hospitality, or naked and give you clothing? When did we ever see you sick or in prison and visit you? And the king will say, I tell you the truth, when you did it to one of the least of these, my brothers and sisters, you were doing it to me. That's why it matters. Because even serving a breakfast or opening our doors for someone to have a place to come and have their meeting is us doing as unto the Lord what he has called us to do. To practically meet needs, to practically show his love, to practically be involved in the world around us, because this isn't the church. We are the church. Number three, being the church looks like being committed to evangelism. We'll not shy away from this point. The most important thing that we will ever do is proclaim the love of Jesus and the plan of salvation, that he came to rescue lost people, to give us a hope and a future. We will always proclaim that gospel of who Jesus is and why he came. And that's what the filling of the Holy Spirit empowers us to do. Acts 1:8, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. You will be my witnesses, telling people about me everywhere, in Jerusalem, throughout Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. It says in Matthew chapter 5, 14 through 16, you are the light of the world. Here's our purpose as the body. Here's our purpose as the church. You're the light of the world, like a city on a hilltop that cannot be hidden. No one lights a lamp and then puts it under a basket. Instead, a lamp is placed on a stand where it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your good deeds shine out for all to see, so that everyone will praise your heavenly Father. We are committed to helping people see our Father in heaven. We're committed to that. We're committed to making his name famous, his message known. Word says that when he's lifted up, he will draw all men into himself. And so we're going to declare as a people who we serve, who our God is, so that he can then begin to draw people to himself. I'm going to ask the worship team if you would come and just prepare. We'll land this plane. All these things that we're leaning into are encouragements to us to be active as the church. We are filled by Jesus with the Holy Spirit for the reason of encouraging each other to be the church. It is active and it is in motion and it's for a purpose. Because when Jesus said in Matthew 6:18, on this rock, the rock of the gospel, I will build my church and the gates of hell will not prevail against it, we have to understand that word picture. And this is nothing new, you've probably heard this, but listen, gates are not an offensive weapon. There's been no war movie that depicted the enemy picking up their gates from their city wall and running into battle with them. Gates are defensive, gates are stable, they're solid. Gates are not meant to go on the offense. So when he says that the gates of hell will not stand against my church that I'm building, it means that we are called to be active, going into dark places with the light of the gospel, so that more people may know who this Jesus is. More people may hear this message. And just like gates are not offensive, a building is not offensive either. So this church cannot be defined by this building, because this building can't go into battle. This building cannot go and rescue the lost. This building cannot go and reach the needs of people practically in Edmond. This building cannot go and tell people that God loves them and has a wonderful plan for their life. Send his son Jesus. The building can't do that, but we can do that. We are called to go. We are called to be active. We are called to be on the move. We, the people of God, I could have just said this at the beginning and been done 25 minutes ago. I apologize. We as the people of God must rise up empowered by the Holy Spirit and be the church. That's it. That's the message. That's the calling. That's the goal. That's the end result. When he says, I will build my church, what he's saying is, I will raise up a body of people who will be in unity together to go into this world and meet the needs of the world around them so that more people can know that I love them, that I have hope for them, that I want to rescue them. So please don't take this as a condemnation for not doing something. But I just want to make sure that we come together in unity and change our thinking from showing up to church to looking in the mirror every day knowing that I am the church. I'm the church that God is raising up because we together are the plan that he has. He's not waiting to see if this works and then he might send Jesus again to try over. We are it. His people united together to spread the name of Jesus. That's the plan. That's the goal. I want to ask us to stand if you would. And we're going to spend a couple moments in prayer. And we're just going to lean into this idea. Lord, would you fill me so that I can be the church? We can't do this on our own. It's not the purpose. It's not the goal. The church isn't man-made. We need to be filled by his Holy Spirit, his very presence, so that we can accomplish the purpose he has for us. Being his church, active in this world, meeting needs. So I just want to ask if you would pray with me. I'm going to lead us in prayer, but pray that you would take that role on personally, not waiting for someone else, not waiting for the organization of the church to do it, but that you would accept the mantle of being his church, that we would grow in unity, that we would be active in outreach, that we would be committed to evangelism on a daily basis. Let's just join together in prayer for a moment, can't we? Father, we thank you. God, I thank you for your incredible Holy Spirit. Spirit, we thank you that you make yourself available to us, or that you are with us, you are in us. So God, we just ask that you fill us fresh, fill us anew this morning with your Spirit, because we believe that being filled with your Spirit is the necessary component to being your church. And so we just rest in you. We rely on you. We need your presence. We need your power. We need your calling. We need your purpose. Fill us, God, to be your church. Fill us, God, to accomplish your mission to seek and to save the lost, to go into all the world proclaiming the good news that there is a hope, that there is a Savior. His name is Jesus. Fill us to accomplish your purpose. Commit ourselves to you. We commit this body to you, this family to you. Lord, would you just unite us in a brand new way? I thank you for what you're doing in this body, what you're doing in this place. And I just pray that you would continue your work of unifying us, that we would be dynamically connected to go and accomplish your purpose. Continue your work of leading us in outreach into our community. God, I just declare now that this church body, this family would be known as a light in this community. There would be a knowledge about Spring Creek Assembly that those are people that are meeting needs. Those are people that are sharing the love of God. Those are people that are way beyond four walls. Let us be known by our action. Let us be known by following your Spirit every single day. And we thank you for it, Lord. We thank you for it. I want to ask the most important question that we will ever ask. And that's if you're here today in this room you've never said yes to Jesus, or maybe it's been a really long time, and you're not living for Him, you're not living in a relationship with Him, can I tell you the incredible promise of God? He sent His Son Jesus, because every one of us has made mistakes, every one of us has fallen short, and He sent Jesus to give His life for us. And the power of God raised Him back to life so that He can offer us brand new life. Abundant life here on earth and eternal life in heaven. And the only thing required of us is to say yes. To believe that God really did that. He really sent Jesus and He raised Him from the dead. And to confess that Jesus is now Lord, which means He's in control. We just give our life to Him. We let Him lead us. So if you're here and you've never said yes to Jesus, or it's been a really long time and you know today I need to say yes to Him being my Lord, my rescuer, would you just lift your hand? No one looking around for just a moment. If you just slip your hand and say, that's me, I need to say yes to Jesus today. If you're online, you're watching right where you are, you can lift your hand. Say, that's me, I need to say yes to Jesus. Church, by faith, we know that weekly we've been seeing people come to the knowledge of who Jesus is, putting their faith in Him. So we believe that either watching online or in this room, we want to create the opportunity for you to receive Jesus, whether you raise your hand or not. So I want to ask if you would repeat this prayer after me. Say, Heavenly Father, I know that I've made mistakes, and I know that I can't save myself. Would you forgive me? And make me new. I believe that you sent Jesus, and that He gave His life for me, and that you raised Him back to life. I confess Jesus as Lord, and I know that I'm saved. Thank you for your love. Help me live for you, no matter what. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, can we celebrate life change and rescue? Thank you, Lord.
You are good. In the morning I'll see you. Are good. In the evening I'll see you. Are good. You are good to me. Yeah. You
good to us, isn't He? It's good to be with the family this morning. It's good to be with the body of Christ. I'm so glad you're here, and I'm going to ask you for just a moment, nobody leave, nobody distract, because I want to do this really fast. If you made that decision today, there's no better decision to make, and we want to walk with you. We want to be a part of that family that encourage you, that equip you, that empower you. So I'm going to ask you to do this. Fill out one of those Connect cards. If you didn't fill one out, grab it now, even as I'm talking. Grab one of those cards, fill it out, hand it to a pastor, put it in one of the offering boxes, hand it to one of our family hosts out front at the desk. At the very top, it says, I committed my life to Jesus today. It's just going to let us celebrate with you. We're going to come alongside you, partner you with people, give you resources like this rescued book that talks about all what it means to be rescued. There is just an excitement when we see God changing people's lives, and we want to be with you in that. There's some of you that maybe you've said yes several weeks, months ago, but you haven't gotten plugged in. You haven't been a part of what God's doing yet. We encourage you, grab one of these books. Come let us know. Fill out one of the cards. Join us at Growth Track next week. It's a great opportunity to get plugged in. And I want to just encourage you with this. Let's go this week. Let's be the church. Let's love people. Let's serve people. Let's tell them what Jesus has done in our lives. Amen. We love you. Hope you have a wonderful, wonderful rest of your Sunday. We'll see you Wednesday night at prayer service.